SDN Communications, providing network uptime for businesses reliant on broadband and internet connectivity. Learn more at sdncommunications.com.
You're watching a production of South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
State House program funding provided by the South Dakota Bar Foundation, the educational and charitable arm of South Dakota lawyers and judges.
This will be his recommendations for fiscal year 2015. They have convened this morning. Lieutenant Governor Matt Michaels is at the podium right now.
That's right, and we don't quite know what the governor specifically is going to say. We've heard rumors of a moderate increase. We've heard talk of some people are going to be pleased. Education may or may not be pleased. They're looking for 3.8% increase to kind of make up from some budget cuts back in 2011. We're going to hear about Medicaid expansion, those kinds of things, those kinds of issues coming up, but we don't know the details yet, but we will find out very soon as the governor makes his way to the podium.
One of the things expected to come up is the unclaimed property bank account. It's got some high numbers in it. It will come up, although those are considered one-time monies, and in the past, the governor has always said he does not like to put one-time monies in ongoing expenses. So we'll see just how high the unclaimed property bank account is and maybe what his ideas could be for where that money could go.
But he's not saying any program expansions or any new programs coming. That's coming from him this year. So we'll wait and see what he has to say.
They are giving applause to one of the retiring Sergeant of Arms. Right now, I think it would be appropriate to go down to the House floor and listen to Lieutenant Governor Matt Michaels.
Daugaard.
Thank you. Thank you, Matt. Hey, Julie, good to see you. Hello, good to see you. Lieutenant Governor,
yes,
thank
sir.
You.
Thank you.
Mr. Speaker.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Shelley? Thank you very much. Please take your seats. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you and welcome. It's good to be here with you, and I'm very pleased that so many of you came in spite of the snowy weather and the slippery roads. Thank you very much for being here. Today, of course, I'm here to offer my budget proposal for fiscal year 15. But before I do that, I'd like to recognize a few people. With us today are three legislators who will be joining us here in Pierre for the coming session. Please, those of you, as I call your name, please stand and please help me welcome Senator Blake Curd, Representative Dave Anderson, and Representative Chris Langer. In today's remarks, I'm going to be updating you on the state's economy, reviewing our revenues and expenses for the current year and offering my proposals for the next year. Now, to begin with, I want to talk about how this budget came together over the past couple of months. Until recently, the landscape was not very promising. On June 30th, at the end of the fiscal 13 year, despite ending with a $24 million nominal surplus, our ongoing revenue in FY13 was $4.5 million below the adopted estimates. So our revenue base was lower before fiscal year 2014, our current year, even began. And because our revenue base was lower, preliminary revisions for the current year that we're in now We're about 6 million short of what the adopted estimates were. So in September, things didn't look very good. Our initial FY15 estimates in September projected increased revenue of $41.4 million. That's in the blue. However, to fund just minimum increases in the largest expense categories, we'd need $62.9 million. That's the red bar. Those budget categories included an inflationary increase of 1.6% for education, K-12 education, an FMAP change of 2.08% for Medicaid, provider inflation at 1.6% plus mandatory provider inflation, entitlement eligibles growth, that is eligibles for Medicaid and CHIPS, and also utilization growth by those entitled and enrolled, state health insurance costs, an inflationary increase for state employees of 1.6, and a transfer from general funds to Building South Dakota's fund. Now that $62.9 million did not include anything for the Board of Regents, nothing for the tech schools, nothing for the other executive departments, nothing for maintenance of repair increases. That was just for the 1.6, so things didn't look very good. Fortunately, the situation has changed since September, and of course the most significant change was in the unclaimed property that we received just last month. As you look at it, unclaimed property has been very unpredictable over the past several years. In FY14, we projected an increase for two reasons. One, you might remember, in recent years, several banks have relocated their home offices into South Dakota because of our positive regulatory climate. And that increased the unclaimed property that became part of South Dakota's unclaimed property. Second, in 2012, I proposed and you passed House Bill 1270, which changed the time period, shortened the time period after which unclaimed property is presumed to be abandoned. It used to be 5 years. I proposed and you shortened it to 3 years. These two actions increased our unclaimed property receipts, and we knew they would jump because of 5 year and 4 year and 3 year property all coming in this year, in fiscal year 14. And they increased our unclaimed property receipts to over $30 million in FY13, and our projections in FY14 were over $50 million. For FY15, we originally projected about $34 million in ongoing unclaimed property, the far right bar. Even after projecting these increases, though, unclaimed property changed significantly in the last month. The November 1 annual unclaimed property transfers exceeded $125 million. Two banks alone submitted $122 million in unclaimed property. This chart shows the actual receipts of $122 million after you net out projected refund claims of about three. So $122 is the net. And working with the treasurer's office, we believe $67.5 million of that $122 figure will be repeated next year in FY15. So you see the total of 67.5 on the far right bar as the new ongoing estimate of unclaimed property. So as we worked to craft this year's budget, this single development dramatically affected both ongoing and one-time revenue projections. And let me tell you how I've worked these changes into my proposed budget. First, I want to discuss the ongoing increase. We jumped the ongoing increase when we received the property in 14. For FY15, we increased it by $33.5 million. And the difference between the original FY15 estimate of $34 million and today's estimate of $67.5 million is that difference of $33.5 million. And remember, a minute ago I said we were about $20 million short of even providing a 1.6 minimal inflationary increase and other normal expenses. And the ongoing unclaimed property revenue now is enough to fund that minimal level and to provide funding for the regents and the technical institutes. It gets us to 1.6%. It's not enough to increase funding by much more than that, however, unless we take some other steps. And to do that, I look to the one-time money that we have available. And we all know there's plenty of good uses for one-time money. I've proposed them before, some of you have proposed them before. Although schools, providers, and other recipients of state funds appreciate one-time money, they very much prefer ongoing dollars. I've heard this many times, and I'm sure you've heard it too. They want to build reliable, ongoing resources into their base budget. So this year, I propose we use one-time money to free up ongoing money. And I'm proposing two approaches to do that. And that'll free up over $23 million in ongoing dollars for our FY15 ongoing budget. Let's take a look. First, I propose using $30 million of one-time money to pre-fund the Building South Dakota program created by Senate Bill 235 last session. If you recall, Senate Bill 235 requires 25% of the unclaimed property receipts in 2015, in FY15, and 50% of the unclaimed property receipts in every year thereafter to be deposited into the Building South Dakota Fund. If instead we pre-fund this program now, we protect it from future fluctuations in unclaimed property. We also guarantee that this funding will be available over the next several years, and it will not compete for ongoing dollars with schools and providers during that time. Pre-funding Building South Dakota frees up $16.9 million in ongoing money. And here's how that increases ongoing revenue. Remember, our initial FY15 revenue growth estimate was $41.4 million. To that, we'll add $3.8 million in revised revenue growth projections. Next, we add the revised revenue from the unclaimed property. Remember, that was $33.5 million more. And then we would, under present law, subtract $16.9 million under the current law as a tax expenditure for Senate Bill 235 for the Building South Dakota program. And then the net total ongoing revenue growth would be 61.8. Remember, that's the level at which we can just afford the 1.6% increase. However, if we pre-fund the Building South Dakota program with one-time dollars, we can eliminate that tax expenditure. And our projected ongoing revenue growth improves by that $16.9 million to a total of $78.7 million in ongoing revenue growth in FY15. Remember this 78.7 number because you'll see it again. Let's look more closely now at my proposal to pre-fund Building South Dakota. When Building South Dakota was established, it was projected to receive $7.3 million in fiscal year 15. And if you look at the bottom of that first dollar column, $36.4 million over the first 3 years. That was the projection. However, these were ongoing funds, and the law included a trigger that suspends the transfer and the funding in a year when there's not enough money for schools, providers, and state salary policy. If not for the unclaimed property growth that we suddenly experienced in November, that could have happened this year. Pre-funding this year will allow Building South Dakota to operate for several years at the funding level originally planned. It'll also give us all time to see how quickly the grant applications are made and how quickly dollars are allocated. Over the next couple of years, additional funds can be allocated to add to the $30 million so that we can keep pace with the funding level that was planned. By pre-funding Building South Dakota with $30 million this year, we guarantee that we'll receive more funding than was planned in FY15. In fact, we'll appropriate the dollars a year early in FY14. So Building South Dakota will receive, yet this year, nearly as much as it was projected to receive over 3 years. Pre-funding means Building South Dakota will not compete with schools and providers for ongoing dollars. Doing this frees enough ongoing dollars to fund schools, providers, and salary policy at a higher level. The second approach uses one-time dollars to prepay outstanding bond liabilities. I propose using $58.1 million to prepay four outstanding South Dakota Building Authority bond issues by either calling them or escrowing funds now to pay them at maturity. This will save $6.3 million of general funds in FY15 and future years. This slide shows, as you can see, $30 million and $58.1 million, $88.1 million total in one-time uses. But remember, the increase in FY14 unclaimed property only totals $68.5 million. So where does the rest of the one-time money come from? Well, remember, at the end of fiscal year 13, the state had a nominal surplus of $24.2 million. At the end of June of this year, we reported a nominal surplus of $24.2 million. Under the law, those dollars automatically went into our reserve funds. The legislature never had an opportunity to appropriate them or to consider how to use those dollars. I propose we use part of it to prepay bonds. Last year's state cash flow fund, into which these dollars are now invested, earned only 1.3% interest. Currently, this year so far, we're earning 1.1% interest. It makes sense to use one-time dollars to pay off higher interest bonds. This is a prudent use of one-time dollars to remove a liability. Just as in your own home, you might use an inheritance to pay off your mortgage early. It doesn't affect your net worth. It offsets the asset against the liability, but it does mean you don't have to make those mortgage payments anymore, just as we won't have to make $6.3 million in principal and interest payments out of the general fund anymore. Let's look at that in detail. These are the four bond issues I propose we prepay. They're for state facilities, and you can see the principal and interest payments are covered with general funds. These bonds finance the Mickelson DCI building here in Pierre. The second one is part of the Board of Regents science facilities all over the state in colleges and universities. The Mickelson Human Services Center in Yankton is the third bond issue. And then finally, the Mickelson Human Services Center dietary wing is the fourth bond issue. The second column shows the payoff amount for each bond. And at the bottom, you can see at the bottom you can see the $58.1 million that I'm proposing to spend in prepayments. Prepaying the bonds will save $6.3 million annually, in red there. We'll also save $13.3 million in future interest and fees, primarily from the first two bonds listed. Prepaying these will result in substantial interest and fee savings over the life of the bonds, as their yields are currently over 4.5%. We can't call the last two bonds issued, so there are minimal interest and fee savings, but we can pre-fund an escrow account that will pay the bonds at maturity, and this gets the annual principal and interest payment off our general fund obligations. These four bonds, if prepaid, will result in the red number there, $6.3 million in general fund savings for FY15 and future years. And as I mentioned, the $13 million I'm not even talking about. That's in out years. The $6.3 million we realize right away in FY15 and in other years beyond. But remember this $6.3 million. You'll see it on the next chart. Prepaying the bond will reduce FY15 expenses. Remember, the cost of funding minimal increases, including inflation at 1.6%, is that $62.9 million figure. In other budget areas, we have expense increases and some expense decreases with a net expense increase of $5.2 million. Prepaying the bonds, as I just demonstrated in the prior chart, decreases expenses by $6.3 million. And if we wanted to fund K-12 providers and salary policy at 3% rather than 1.6%, it will cost us an extra $16.9 million. By using the one-time dollars as proposed, we increase ongoing revenue to 78.7. By prepaying bonds, we cut expenditures down to 78.7. These two moves allow me to propose a budget to you that reaches 3% funding increases for schools, providers, and state employees. That's kind of a broad look at the budget, and I'll detail it for you more, but I want to step back now and give you some overview. Things look pretty bleak in September, but today's outlook is better. But before I detail the proposal any further, I want to take a few minutes to talk about South Dakota's economy. This chart plots South Dakota and the United States' non-farm employment. Non-farm employment is closely watched because it provides a timely measure of the health of the labor market and overall economy. South Dakota non-farm employment is the blue line, and it's measured on the right scale. The United States is the red line, and it's measured on the left scale. And we use a ratio chart so that it is fair to compare those lines one to another if you have the similar ratio on the left and on the right, and we do. Looking at South Dakota, the blue line, prior to the recession, you can see we were experiencing strong employment growth. We were adding non-farm jobs. However, when the recession hit, employment levels dropped. In total, 12,300 jobs were lost in South Dakota, or a decline of about 3%. In 2010, we began regaining jobs. And in 2012, you can see we surpassed our previous employment peak. That's the dotted line. We bumped up against the peak and kept on going. As of October of this year, South Dakota total employment was 420,000 people, which is 2% above our pre-recession peak. Only 16 states have surpassed at all their pre-recession peak. We're 2% above our peak. So South Dakota's fortunate. Now look at the red line. The United States was adding jobs until the recession when employment dropped. In total, 8.7 million jobs were lost in the United States, a decline of 6.3%. Remember, ours dropped only 3%. As of October 13, the U.S. employment was 136.6 million, still 1.5 million jobs below the previous peak, or about 1.1% below. You can see the bracket on the right that shows the dotted line is still above the solid red line. There's still a gap between current levels and the previous peak. It took South Dakota 48 months to return to peak employment. For the United States, 69 months and counting, we're still below our pre-recession peak. So again, South Dakota has much to be thankful for. The next four charts display key indicators that the South Dakota is outperforming the U.S. economy. The first chart, the top left graph, is a look at some of the same things we just looked at in a different way. It looks at non-farm job growth of the United States and South Dakota, only the percentage of growth. Since 2007, in South Dakota, our growth of non-farm job has averaged 0.8%, almost 1% a year. United States average during that period is zero. They were up, then they were down. They still haven't regained where they were. So again, a good thing for South Dakota. The top right chart shows South Dakota's unemployment rate remains significantly lower than the U.S. unemployment rate. Last month, the national unemployment rate was reported at 7.3% compared to South Dakota's rate of 3.7%. South Dakota's unemployment rate is nearly half of the United States rate. Our rate is second lowest in the nation, behind only North Dakota. The bottom two graphs show South Dakota's income has grown at a faster rate than the United States since 2007. The bottom left shows South Dakota's non-farm income growth, which has averaged 4.9% since 2007, while the United States' non-farm income growth has been 3.1%. The bottom right brings in the effect of ag income as well. So it shows per capita income. In 2007, we were just 93% of what the U.S. average was. And then you can see ours grew above the U.S. average. By 2012, we were 103.8% of the U.S. average. South Dakota's 2012 per capita personal income was $45,381 per person, compared to the U.S. average of $43,735. $5 per person. We're about $2,000 per person above the U.S. average. And of course, our strong farm economy has been a significant reason for the growth in per capita income in recent years. Overall, we're fortunate that South Dakota continues to outperform the national economy by most measures. Now let's go back to the budget, and we'll take a look at the tax revenues upon which our budget is built. For the past 3 years, we've taken a prudent approach to estimating revenues. We use sound, cautious economic assumptions based on the input of the Council of Economic Advisors from all over South Dakota. We select revenue estimates that have a high probability of attainment, not just a 50% probability, but a high probability of attainment. And we use long-term baselines to protect ongoing expenses from short-term fluctuations. And I very much appreciate that you, as legislators, have taken this approach as well. Over the past few years, the Legislative Research Council's independent revenue projections have been very close to the Bureau of Finance and Management's revenue projections, and you have adopted estimates within those projections, and I appreciate that. We have a lot to be proud of in South Dakota. Our economy has weathered the recession well, and we've continued to outperform most of the rest of the nation. Why is that? I believe partly because we continue to be good stewards of our state. We brought our budget into structural balance, and we've kept it there. We've resisted the temptation to overestimate revenue. Many states do this, very common. We don't adopt overly optimistic revenue estimates. If the revenue does come in better than projected, we spend it after it's in hand. And when in hand, we propose not only to spend the improvement in the revenue as a one-time expenditure mid-year when it's more identifiable, but we also build it into the base for next year's ongoing expenses. And when we have the opportunity, we also reduce liabilities. We are in an enviable position because we made difficult decisions 3 years ago, and we've adhered to structurally sound management principles. That means that even in a year when revenue growth is a little slow, our budget discussion can be about increases, not about freezes or cuts. Being conservative is very important as we estimate revenues, and I'd like to take a look at that next. You've seen this chart before. It's a history of ongoing revenue estimating, and it compares what the legislature originally adopted when they adopted the budget for the following fiscal year and what actually came in at the end of that year. And I show this chart every year because it reminds us all of how important it is to continue to maintain fiscal discipline. This chart shows the history of the original adopted legislative estimates and actual receipts. Before fiscal year 2009, receipts were close to the estimate, but you can see how the recession reduced our revenue in FY2009 and FY10, and our receipts were much lower than the adopted estimates. We got back on track, and we've been more conservative as the receipts have exceeded the estimates for the past few years. In FY14, it appears the revised estimate will again be higher than the adopted estimate by about $33.2 million. It's important to remember, though, the FY14 estimate at this stage would be very close to the adopted estimate if not for that unexpected windfall from unclaimed property. Let's take a look at detailed revenue revisions for the year we're in right now, fiscal year 2014. This chart details the changes from the estimates you adopted last March to what we now believe will be received by the end of this current year. This is, again, the current year, which began last July 1, will end next June 30th. Sales and use tax collections have improved the past 2 months, and the estimates have increased by $4.7 million. The property tax reduction fund estimate has been lowered by $2.9 million, primarily due to soft video lottery receipts so far this fiscal year. The contractor's excise tax and insurance company tax are both up $1.1 million and $1.8 million, respectively, due to improved collections in these areas. The ongoing unclaimed property estimate, of course, increased dramatically from $29.1 million to $67.5 million due to the windfall that was recently received. That's an increase of $38 million over the adopted estimate. Licenses, permits, and fees are down slightly. Net transfers down slightly. Trust fund transfers slightly higher. The bank franchise tax, let's look at that. It's been revised lower. Remember, last year in the adopted budget, we included a historical average amount, less one standard deviation to project what would be our bank franchise tax, especially for bank card tax in ongoing receipts. And we projected $16.6 million of ongoing bank card tax receipts and $6.6 million in other bank income, traditional franchise banking income, a total of $23.2 million in the adopted estimate. The bank card portion of the bank tax has been revised lower, now projected at $9.5 million, or a decrease of $6.1 million compared to the adopted estimate. That accounts for the majority of the reduction in the bank franchise tax estimate. That represents an 18.7% loss of the total growth over the adopted estimate. Other ongoing receipts revised down slightly by $3.1 million, primarily from a decrease in severance tax estimates. In total, ongoing receipts for FY14 now are revised significantly higher by $33.2 million compared to the adopted estimate. And you can see, but for the unclaimed property receipts, it would actually be a revision down. So the unclaimed property receipts gave us a positive number, which would otherwise have been a lower number. Let's look at FY15 now. This chart compares current revenue estimates, the ones we just revised, to as of today, to what we think now FY15 will bring. FY15, of course, starts next July and ends June 30, 2015. Sales tax is projected at $835.2 million, up $25.1 million for FY2015. There's two limits on growth in the sales and use tax line that have impacted the estimate. First, 2015 represents the first full year of the collection allowance that retailers are starting to take out of this tax. They have a full year. That collection allowance starts next month and reduces sales tax by about $5 million in 2015. Secondly, under current federal law, South Dakota will lose the ability to assess sales tax on internet access service fees. Now, don't confuse this with sales tax on internet goods purchased. It's a tax on what one pays to their provider to have internet services. Starting on November 1, 2014, we'll no longer be able to assess that tax, which is currently in law. The resulting 2015 sales tax loss is about $5.4 million. These two revenue losses, of course, as I mentioned, have been incorporated into the 835 number. That's net of those two losses. The property tax reduction fund is projected to grow by $2.1 million, reflecting moderate increases in video lottery. The contractor's excise tax is projected to grow by $5.3 million as we expect continued growth in construction activity in 2015. Insurance company tax also projected to grow $3.5 million in 2015 as insurance premium increases occur. Ongoing unclaimed property receipts, I mentioned earlier, are projected at $67.5 million, no increase from the current level that we just collected earlier last month. The license, permits, and fees category and net transfers in category are expected to show small increases of $1.2 million and $0.6 million. Trust fund transfers are projected to increase $2.1 million due to improving returns in the financial markets. Of course, the stock market went up, so the value of all our trust funds is up, and so multiply that against the average market value over 16 quarters times 4%, and that's what you get. That's up. The bank franchise tax is expected to grow by just $500,000, with total collections at $17.5 million in FY2015. Again, some perspective on that tax. Over the past 8 years, which includes the recession and lower collection amounts, average collections from bank franchise taxes is $30 million. So this revenue source is significantly lower than historical levels. The other ongoing receipts are slightly lower by $0.4 million in 2015 due to the decrease in the sale leaseback annuity and another, as I mentioned, a decline in severance taxes. So in total, FY2015 receipts ongoing are projected at $1,393.7 million, with a growth of $40 million over the revised 2014 estimates. Due to the conservative approach used to project revenue, we're able to fund additional growth in expenses that we would not otherwise be able to fund. The 2013 legislature adopted a budget which left a structural surplus on the bottom line of 2013. That is the difference between adopted ongoing revenue and adopted ongoing expenses. In FY2014, the revisions to ongoing revenue growth compared to what we actually the actual receipts as compared to the adopted estimates was $33.2 million, as I mentioned a little bit earlier. And as I just mentioned, the growth in 2015, we believe, will be about $40 million. So in total, there's $78.7 million of ongoing revenue available for increased expenses in 2015. So now that we've talked about revenue, let's look at expenses in detail. As we look at new spending, our first priority must always be sure that we do not fall back into structural deficit. How do we do that? Well, we spend new dollars only when the revenues to support them are highly probable. We increase ongoing spending cautiously in areas that we can sustain long term, and we use one-time dollars to reduce liabilities or ongoing expenses. The funding formula for state aid to K-12 education and special ed called for a 1.6% increase. But by utilizing the one-time funds as shown earlier, I can propose to you a 3% increase for K-12. I'm also proposing a 3% increase for the technical institutes. The Board of Regents, of course, does not have a funding formula, but instead makes specific requests for specific increases. This year, I'm recommending funding for specific items, which total a 2.6% increase. On top of that 2.6 increase, but not included in that, I'm recommending that we use general funds to freeze university tuition for in-state, on-campus students. These dollars will go to the regents, but will be passed into the pockets of our university students in the form of lower tuition costs. The formula we use for Medicaid provider increases would call for a 1.6% increase. It's based on prospective inflation. But I'm proposing the same 3% increase that K-12 and others are receiving. Finally, I propose a 3% cost of living adjustment for state employee salaries. I am not proposing the use of one-time funds to augment any of these increases this year. The increases I'm proposing are all ongoing increases that will be built into the base. Now, this summarizes my 2015 recommended ongoing expenses. First, education as a general category, $19.2 million. Medical and provider assistance, $39.2 million. State employee compensation package, $20.3 million. All the rest, $6.2 million, and then, as I mentioned, the bond prepayment savings of $6.3 million brings us to a total general fund increase of $78 million in ongoing expenses. Now, those are all the major categories. Let's look at the major categories in more detail. We'll start with education increases of $19 million. First, state aid to education, $8 million. This includes 3% inflation in general education, special education, and sparsity payments. As I already mentioned, I'm proposing a Regents resident tuition freeze as a proactive step to keep college affordable. The Board of Regents in-state resident tuition freeze would be $4 million to guarantee there'll be no tuition increase for in-state on-campus students for the 2014-2015 school year. Similarly, I'm recommending a technical institute tuition buy-down of $1 million cost. I'm proposing that $1 million buy down tuition at the technical institutes up to $5 per credit hour. So it's similar in application to the way the Board of Regents will help hold down tuition. Similarly, this will allow the technical institutes to hold down tuition. Board of Regents M&R, $1.6 million. This is the second year of a four-year plan to gradually increase our allocation in the budget for maintenance and repair to reach 2% of the replacement value of our state buildings. So this would get us step two of a four-year plan. Board of Regents Utilities, $1.2 million to cover increased utilities seen in both the current fiscal year and projected in fiscal year 2015, primarily in natural gas and propane. Also, to ensure we have an adequate number of physicians to take care of South Dakota patients, we have to expand our medical school class. The medical school expansion of $1 million would allow the med school to add 11 new MD students next year, and when fully implemented, they'd keep adding 11 to each entering class, so we'd eventually have a med school that would have 44 more students when fully implemented than the med school currently has in their current four-year set of classes. The Technical Institute bonds, this is an $875,000 budget recommendation due to the passage of House Bill 1098 during last session. The state committed to matching the Technical Institute's financial commitment to bond payments on a 1-to-2 ratio. This fulfills that commitment. And then the Technical Institute formula of $800,000, this is the 3% formula increase. You can see the other Technical Institute payments are on top of that last $778,000 figure. The $778,000 alone is the 3% increase. Let's move on. The next major category is medical assistance. Totals, as you can see, $39.2 million. Medical provider inflation is $15.7 million. The majority of this is $12 million for a 3% inflationary increase on average to Medicaid providers. The remainder is comprised of $1.1 million in child care direct assistance, $1.8 million mandatory inflationary increases required by the federal government, as well as increased inflationary costs related to expanded medical health services and TANF-related services. But most of it is a flat 3% increase on average to Medicaid providers. FMAP, the federal medical assistance percentage, is shifting. South Dakota's blended rate will now become 47.88%. That means out of every dollar spent in South Dakota on Medicaid, South Dakota pays 47.88 cents, and the federal government pays a little over 50 cents. And this means as we shoulder more than 2% more, it means $15.6 million is simply shifted from the federal shoulders to our shoulders. We don't get any more services for it. We don't get any more payments to providers for it. They don't get anything more. It just means that when a dollar is paid to them, more of it's coming out of the state pocket than the federal pocket. And that's probably going to happen again next year. This is, as I mentioned, a cost shift from the federal government to the state. 6.7 is growth in eligibles and utilization. We have about 115,000 to 116,000 people on Medicaid and CHIPs today. The rate of enrollment growth has slowed, even flattened, and in some months gone down recently. But we know that as people start to enroll in the Affordable Care Act exchanges or go to their insurers, they will be steered to Medicaid. And those who are eligible but not enrolled today, what's called the woodwork effect. They'll come out of the woodwork where we don't see them and don't know them and haven't enrolled them. They will come out and enroll. And so we do expect there will be growth to some degree. And as I say, as individuals go to the federal exchange to seek coverage, they will be steered to the state. Right now we're already getting paper forms, flat files, from the federal government saying, check this person, check that person. They look like they're eligible. And then we have to reply, they're already enrolled. They're already enrolled. They're already enrolled in almost all the cases. But some, as more and more people go on to that exchange, we'll find some, and that enrollment will grow from those currently eligible. In addition, those already enrolled tend to increase utilization over time. Between increased enrollment and increased utilization in Medicaid and our correctional health care system, we're projecting increased expense of about $6.7 million. Then there's another miscellaneous group of $1.2 million, includes various increases and decreases such as utilities, internal service rates, food service rates, expanding our workforce initiatives, all related to medical and provider assistance. I am not recommending to expand Medicaid in the FY2015 budget. The implementation of the Affordable Care Act continues to be unpredictable and chaotic. From the delay of the employer mandate, to postponing the shop exchange, to the one-year postponement of the cancellation of non-compliant policies, to the initial operating failure of the federal exchange, I continue to have doubts about the federal government's ability to deliver on their promises. The next slide shows the recommended changes for our workforce. In any organization, the most important resource are the employees. And for state employee compensation, my recommendation, I'm proposing a 3% cost of living and market adjustment for all permanent state employees. I'm also recommending the continuation of the performance and compensation equity system that Governor Mickelson put in place for 2015 with 3% adjustments towards job worth for employees paid below the midpoint of their pay range. I'm proposing that we continue the career banding and pay for performance system that was put into place last year. This allows these employees to receive increases towards market based on their performance evaluated against established accountabilities. This is in lieu of the flat 3% that others would get. This is performance driven. Some get zero of that money. Following the completion of a total compensation market analysis, I'm also recommending funding for targeted compensation adjustments for a small number of mostly vocational jobs that are below market, experiencing high turnover, a decline in applicants, or are difficult to fill because of the nature of the work. This includes custodians, groundskeepers, and direct care providers such as nurses' aides, and I hope you'll support me on that. Even with aggressive management of our employee health plan, we've had another year where estimated savings were not realized. For the employer contribution to the state employee health insurance, I'm recommending $6.8 million to solve the structural deficit in the base rate. The total recommended general fund increase for the state government workforce is $20.3 million. Other recommended ongoing increases include maintenance repair, $3.5 million. Again, this is the second year of the four-year plan to increase the maintenance and repair budget to get our dollars allocated to 2% of the replacement value annually. Also, agriculture rehabilitation, I'm proposing $460,000. The Rural Rehabilitation Fund works with farmers and ranchers, works with local lenders, I should say, to help farmers and ranchers with financing needs. And important agricultural development efforts have slowly depleted this fund, reducing the funding available to assist local farmers and ranchers. And in order to prevent further erosion, I'm recommending funding to correct a structural shortfall that we have in this program. For drug and DUI courts, I'm proposing $396,000. Over the past several years, drug courts have proven a successful alternative to incarceration, and they have reduced recidivism. I'm recommending funding to establish a drug court in Cottington County, as well as expanding the DUI court in both Pennington and Minnehaha counties. For utilities and internal service rates, $351,000. The fourth item, that includes increases necessary to numerous agencies because utility costs and internal service rates charged to the departments by the bureaus are also expected to increase. In other words, as the bureaus' costs increase because of things like utility costs or employee compensation or recommended budget changes, that works into the rates that they charge the other agencies in the state government. Adult education and literacy, I'm proposing $325,000. That's an increase as a result of reduced federal funding from the U.S. Department of Education's Workforce Investment Act In order to continue to provide education services at the current level throughout the state, I'm recommending to maintain this budget with general funds. Second to the last, we've got increase the jail rate to counties. Apart from the reform efforts in last year's Public Safety Improvement Act, I'm proposing $135,000 to increase the rate paid to help counties keep up with jailing expenses. Counties have done a good job of tracking jail bed days used by the state for parolees, and the data shows that this increase is warranted and fair. Then finally, miscellaneous increases and decrease of $1.1 million. Now that we've talked about ongoing expenses, I want to talk about how I propose to spend the significant one-time dollars that are available in fiscal year 14. Now, I spoke last year in the budget address about structural soundness, and I view one-time dollars as an opportunity to increase our structural soundness. And there's different ways you can do that. I see four different ways we can do that. One, we can eliminate liabilities, as I'm proposing this year, by prepaying bonds. Secondly, we can build a new asset or improve an existing asset. Last year, I talked about reinforcing the floor in the rotunda as a good use of one-time money to improve or secure an existing asset. And that's the third one, secure an asset, something you've already got, protect it from deterioration so you can preserve it. Or fourth, we can endow something, an ongoing program in the future. My proposals for one-time funding this year fit into these categories. First, though, I want to explain where did the one-time money come from, because there's a lot of variety of sources where the one-time money came from. This chart shows the sources where they came from. First, the legislature, you, left a nominal surplus of $1.7 million in the adopted FY14 budget. So if you look at the bottom, I talked about how revenue has fallen, but you also have to include where you left us and against that net the change. So the top number there, the $1.7 million, and the bottom in red, they sort of net off against each other, if you will. Secondly, the increase in unclaimed property one-time receipts. This increase in one-time unclaimed property receipts over the adopted estimate this year totals $30.2 million. In other words, we're getting $30.2 million more in one-time money this year than we thought. So it's additional one-time money available that you have not appropriated yet. Most of this is the five-year-old and four-year-old property, just more than we thought would come in, has come in. Liquidation of the 1045B account. You remember that we had an old large project tax refund program that expired at the end of last year. In that, if you had projects over a certain size, you automatically qualified for tax refunds. When the old program was in operation, the revenue department would set aside in advance the tax revenue eligible for refund on qualified projects. Some projects, though, never claimed the refunds, and the time for them to do so is now up. So we have $19.4 million in unrefunded dollars now available on a one-time basis. Bank card reduction. You remember that last year there was great uncertainty about the bank franchise tax, and we knew the tax would continue on an ongoing basis, but because of the 1 year of uncertainty, we included a one-time reduction of $16.6 million in our adopted budget. Some of those issues have been resolved, though, and so we're able to collect these dollars after all. That means this $16.6 million is now available as one-time funds because it wasn't appropriated because of the uncertainty of receipt. A reversion of unexpended carryover. 2 years ago, you appropriated $5 million in one-time funds at my request to the new South Dakotans program. That program has worked more slowly than it hoped, so $4 million of the five is reverting. And that will be available for reappropriation. Increase in ongoing unclaimed property. This is the increase in ongoing unclaimed property receipts, which we just received. It is available one time in FY14. Of course, it's in the base of revenue we are projecting to spend in 2015 on an ongoing basis. But the fact that it shows up as ongoing this year, unexpectedly, means we can spend that increase once. And then change the rest of ongoing. This is the net negative number in ongoing revenue, which impacts fiscal year 2014. And then finally, the transfer from the Property Tax Reduction Fund. This is the transfer from reserves that I already discussed. We'll be using a portion of the surplus from the end of last year to prepay bonds and free up ongoing funds. In total, from revenue changes, these are all revenue changes, we'll have one-time funds of nearly $125 million in 2014. That's from revenue changes. In addition to one-time revenues, we also have some one-time money because we know now, moving into almost the midpoint of 2014, that some of the expenses that you've appropriated dollars for, we're not going to need all those dollars. So they're available for 2014 now. We have one-time money because our expenses are lower than we projected in a couple of major areas. First, the revised Medicaid eligibles revision. As I mentioned, we've seen a flattening out of growth in Medicaid enrollees. And during the recession, there were some months where we added 1,000 people to the Medicaid rolls. Then over the last several years, that increase in the Medicaid rolls month after month has slowed and flattened out. And in some months, we've actually seen a slight decline. Now, as the federal exchange gets ramped up, we think we'll see that start to grow again as exchange participants are steered to Medicaid. But for FY14, we haven't seen it yet, and we're almost halfway through the year. So we're reducing our Medicaid eligibles number down by a little over $6 million. Again, updated projections still show growth, but lower than anticipated. Then finally, the state aid to general ed revision, property valuations for taxes payable in 2014 increased more than budgeted for in 2014, leading to increased local effort. This doesn't mean there's less money for schools, it means there's more property tax revenue available. So that gives some relief to state aid. Now, the seesaw effect will cause us to whipsaw to the other side, and we'll have to pay a little bit more in a future year because of that. But in FY14, there's a little bit less to pay than we had expected. Then finally, we've got a modest continuous appropriation change related to a fire premium refund allocated to the counties. It's a little bit higher than we expected. So that nets against the red numbers and reduces the total decline in adopted expenses to $11.8 million. Then if you add the savings and expenses to the increases in revenue, you get a total of one-time funds available of $136 million. And so next I'll take you through my proposals to spend these one-time dollars. The first category is shortfalls in FY2014, and a few pretty routine expenditures. The state employee health insurance shortfall, the FY2013 health insurance program costs increased significantly more than expected before last year end. And this impacted the base rate that was set for 2014. Even after we revised these estimates during the last session, costs still increased to a far greater degree than the trend line would have indicated they were going to. So when coupled with savings estimates over the last 2 years that were not realized to the extent expected, $8.8 million is necessary to fill the existing funding gap. The second item is, as with the employee health plan, correctional health has also seen an increase. Already this fiscal year, the costs incurred by high need and high cost inmates have surpassed the expenditures paid last year during the same period by 76%. This year, I'm recommending $2 million to cover the shortfall within the 2014 budget and another $1.5 million to establish a reserve so we have a small cushion when unforeseen inmate health care expenditures occur. After the increases of the past 2 years, we've replaced our actuary and hired a different actuary that we hope will help us reach better employee health projections. Our new actuary recommended that we create a $6 million reserve to create a cushion for cost overruns in the plan. And this $1.1 million one-time expenditure, when matched with federal and other funds, will get us about halfway there toward the $6 million reserve. Also, I'm proposing $600,000the DOE technology upgrade, $600,000 of the $1.1 million is to upgrade servers and other infrastructure at the K-12 data center. $500,000 is for a new e-grant system to replace the outdated system that manages grant reporting. Then finally, revised utility projections. The fifth item is an increase of $780,000 projected in utility cost increases for prisons, college campuses, state mental health and developmental disability facilities, and National Guard armories. The internal service rate changes, I talked about how charges or changes in costs to the bureaus get passed on to the agency. So again, the rates charged by the bureaus are expected to increase this year more than anticipated because of cost increases in health insurance, utilities, and operations. And so these funds in the internal service rate changes are needed for agencies to pay these higher rates. And then there's some miscellaneous increases and decreases that net to almost $656,000. Grand total of the general bill amendments for the year we're in right now is $16,703,000. Here are a few more one-time proposals that are consistent with things you've seen before. Tax refunds for the elderly and disabled. This is the annual appropriation that refunds sales and property taxes for elderly and disabled people that meet income guidelines. Secondly, as in the past few years, I'm proposing to use $350,000 this time to treat state lands and protect them from mountain pine beetle infestation. I'm proposing $152,000 to acquire some land adjacent to the Watertown Armory. The land's owned by DOT, so we're paying ourselves, if you will, and the increased acreage would provide space for unit training and equipment adjacent to the armory there. Then finally, Rural Healthcare Recruitment Assistance Program. I know many of you will be familiar with this. We talked about it in the Workforce Initiative a couple of years ago. This would reimburse medical professionals who comply with the requirements of the Rural Healthcare Recruitment Assistance Program that helps serve the increasing medical needs of rural areas. It's a commitment we make to physicians and other health professionals when they agree to practice in a rural area for a certain period of time. So our one-time funds, total of 136. I've got a proposed general bill amendments for 2014 of $16.7 million. Some what I call normal special appropriations bills of a million, and that leaves almost $119 million of one-time funds, and some of this you'll see is what I've already told you about. Here's how I propose to spend that $118 million. First, of course, the $58 million is the largest allocation. That's what I propose to use to prepay those bonds that I detailed for you earlier, free up ongoing dollars, as I've already discussed. Secondly, $30 million to pre-fund Building South Dakota, as I described earlier. Thirdly, cash versus borrowing for the state vet's home. We've successfully brought the state vet's home project back under budget, but I'm proposing instead of borrowing the $16 million that was planned to fund the state share after the federal grant, I'm proposing we use cash instead of borrow. This will mean it won't affect FY15, but it will help us in FY16 and future years, and it's a good use of that money. Another area where I think we can avoid, or in this case reduce, a liability is to eliminate the unfunded accrued actuarial liability for the cement plant retirement fund. Based on current projections, this will eliminate the unfunded liability entirely. Third, the Board of Regents health insurance tuition shortfall. due to the one-time increase to the state employee health plan, which impacts Board of Regents employees, I'm proposing to cover a large portion of the Board of Regents costs with general funds. Last year, this was not in my budget, and you added it. This year, I am including it in my proposal to you. Next, the SDSU swine facility construction. Private donors, including three other states, pork producer groups, are contributing to a new regional swine teaching and research facility at SDSU, and this would help complete the funding. I'm proposing also a one-time use of $1.4 million to construct a new public safety building located in Rapid City. And the new building would be constructed on property owned by the Department of Transportation and adjacent to the current DOT facility. The next item is $1.2 million to the State Railroad Trust Fund. And those funds would be used to make additional loans and grants to improve our state rail structure. One possible use of those funds would be an upgrade to the Missouri River Bridge crossing at Chamberlain and make possible the further upgrade of that line westward from the Missouri River. I'm also proposing $1 million to create a health care provider loan fund to allow health care facilities to make investments in infrastructure to serve the medical needs of South Dakota citizens, and much of this would be used to comply with new federal regulations like sprinklers and other things that some of our nursing homes don't have the capacity to finance right now or cover with their cash. Then finally, the new South Dakotans, Dakota Roots. I'm proposing using $500,000 for our Dakota Roots program to attract out-of-state citizens to move back and work in South Dakota. As I mentioned earlier, we reverted $4 million of the $5 million that had been allocated to the new South Dakotans program, and I'd like to use $500,000 to continue that program for those companies that are participating and also advance the very successful Dakota Roots recruiting program. Now, I'll describe a couple of these in more detail. We looked already at the bond payment, prepayment proposal. We looked already at the pre-fund building South Dakota. Let's take a look at the state vets home proposal. As you remember, the total cost for the new vets home is $41 million. Of course, the bids came in around $51 million. We've got the bids back under budget. We were faced with cost overruns, but we changed the plans and we're now under budget. After the $23.5 million, $23.6 million federal grant and $1.3 million appropriated in 2013, there's $16.4 million that remains. And I'm proposing a one-time appropriation of that $16.3 million rather than borrowing to cover the state's share to construct the state vet's home. Although again, this won't save expenses in FY15, it will save expenses in FY16 and every year thereafter. And those monies then are available for other things in future years. Construction of the new vet's home will begin in the spring of 2014 and would tentatively be finished November of 2015. The state veterans could move in as early as the spring of 2016. And I appreciate the patience of the South Dakota veterans and all individuals that dedicated their time and energy to the state vet's home, and we owe it to the state veterans and South Dakota to finish this project, and I think this is a very cost-effective way of doing it. Here's a little more explanation about the state cement plant retirement fund. When the state sold the Dakota cement plant, we remained responsible for the separate retirement plan of those employees. We talk a lot about the South Dakota retirement system. This is a separate, small, frozen plan for which we are responsible to ensure the retirees, our promises are met. Unfortunately, the funded status of that plan fund as of June 30 was only 87.7% of what the actuaries say will be needed to fulfill the promises made to those employees. This amounted to an unfunded actuarial accrued liability of $7.6 million. Now, recognizing this liability last session, you contributed $2 million to help improve that in fiscal year 2014. However, it remains $5.6 million underfunded still. And I propose we cover this remaining $5.6 liability this year in full. So the retirement fund is fully funded based on the plan's assumptions. Once we make the move, the cement plant fund would compare favorably even to the South Dakota retirement system. If the cement plant fund then joined the South Dakota retirement system, it would be considered to be 107% funded, better than the 103% funding of our state retirement system. That would allow us to combine the cement plant retirement fund and the South Dakota retirement system into one plan, meaning this problem will be solved for good. These proposals I've made will go a long way to improving our state's balance sheet. And I'm sure we'll all have some very good ideas about how to fund or how to spend one-time dollars. However, I believe these proposals will also help us create additional ongoing dollars, not just in fiscal year 15, but also in 16 and years out into the future. So let's look at our new bottom line. The total recommended receipts in FY14 now are revised upward to 1.476, and the total recommended expense the same for a bottom number of zero because of all the one-time money that will not be repeated in FY2015. The revenue numbers are adjusted downward, as are the expenses. Nevertheless, the ongoing expenses in FY15 in many areas will be 3% better than they are in 2014. Now, before I close today, I'd like to talk a little bit about our state's reserve funds. Here's the history over the past few years of our state reserve funds, represented by the blue line. As you can see from this chart, the reserve spiked in FY04. The state used a portion of that to advance the home stake lab, and the rest of it was spent over several years to make up structural deficits. In those years, you saw in red, in that history of ongoing revenue estimation, when we estimated revenue too high and revenue came in lower than that, we spent the reserves to cover the deficit. From fiscal year 08 to 11, no reserves were used because of spending freezes and the use of federal stimulus dollars. In FY12, the first budget I proposed, we originally saw an increase in the reserves, but then we used $20.2 million to cover the costs of the 2011 flood and fires and pine beetle fights. This year, after another increase, the top uppermost text box there where we added $24.2 million, I'm proposing to use 19.6, the lower rightmost text box, use 19.6 in 2014 to reduce liabilities as part of that larger one-time funding use. Now, given the surpluses that we've experienced in the past couple of years, I know many of you have asked, how much is enough in reserves, in our rainy day funds, between the budget reserve and our property tax reduction fund? Those two funds together are our rainy day reserves, if you will. How much is enough? Well, I believe 10% of our general fund expenditures is a prudent target for our state reserves. That's within the range recommended by the National Association of State Budget Officers, and it's considerably less than the average reserves held by other local governments in our state, whether they be counties or cities or schools. They hold, in general, more than that in their reserves. I'm proposing around 10%. Here's where a 10% budget reserve would put us. If you look at the light green line, I know the contrast isn't as good as the blue line, but you can see 10% of general fund expenditures in each of those years. As you can see, from fiscal year 03 to 07, we exceeded this benchmark. The blue line is above the green. So anytime you see the blue line above the green, we have more than 10%. And so you can see in 03 to 07, we were above the green line. Then we dipped below it during the recession. And then at the end of fiscal year 12, general funds remaining at the end of the year not only replenished the reserve, but also increased it to exceed the 10% benchmark. And our use of reserves for emergencies brought us nearer the benchmark. And then after this year's increase, the use of reserves to pay off bonds and free up ongoing money again brings us very close to that 10% mark. This is the approach I'd recommend we follow in the future. When the reserves significantly increase 10% of general fund expenditures, we look for other ways or we consider other ways to use these one-time dollars. I want to thank you for your attention today. That's the proposal I have for you. I want to thank Jason and Liza and Jim and Colin and everybody at the Bureau of Finance and Management for the hard work they did and the long hours and sometimes weeknights and weekends they spent to put this budget together. I know some of the governor's office staff put in some long hours, unusual hours. I know there were fiscal agents of some of the state agencies who put in extra hours to put this budget together. It's unusual. Using these one-time monies in this unusual way took a lot of extra work to analyze how it would impact. And some of it impacted revenues, and some of it impacted expenses. And some impacts offset other impacts. And so it took a lot of work to figure out, and I appreciate all the people who worked hard to do that. I want to thank you again for your attention. I had a few goals as I put together this budget proposal. First, I wanted to maintain structural balance. You probably guessed that. Probably heard me say that more than once. I also wanted to use one-time money to improve the structural soundness of our budget. And I think we'll do that if you agree with my proposals. I wanted to fund above 1.6% if possible, and go 3% for schools, providers, and salary policy. And we found a way to do that if you agree. I wanted to fund the Regents' tuition freeze and do more for the technical institutes. I wanted to fund Building South Dakota at the level we had planned. And this budget achieves all those goals, and it does so in a way that maintains our structural soundness. Because you've joined me in managing our budget responsibly in the past, South Dakota is in a strong position today. Here's what we've done together. As we celebrate 125 years of statehood, we can proudly say we've balanced our budget every single year, honestly, without gimmicks. We've prudently set aside rainy day funds that allow us to address emergencies and seize opportunities. We've not raised taxes. We've used one-time dollars to improve infrastructure, endow programs, and pay off liabilities. We have a state pension fund that's over 100% funded, and we have a plan to fully fund the cement plant retirement fund as well. Because of our work, we can all be proud to have been named the best-run state in America. And we can all be proud to be the number one state for business in the nation. I look forward to continuing to work with you this year, and through your efforts, we're building an even stronger South Dakota. Thank you so much.
Concludes the governor's budget address. Thank you for coming and have a safe trip home.
And that will wrap up the governor's budget address, his recommendations for fiscal year 2015. A few goals that the governor wanted to hit today. One of those, maintain structural balance. He did get a chuckle out of our legislators, as that is one of the key themes that the governor has used throughout his time in office. Use one-time money to improve structural soundness. He wanted to fund above the 1.6%, actually going to 3% for several things. Fund Building South Dakota. Some of the goals that the governor wanted to hit, he feels his recommendations in this budget address today will achieve all of those goals. You are watching the governor's budget address on South Dakota Public Broadcasting, live on television, also being aired on SDPB Radio. If you missed any of what the governor had to say, it will re-air tonight on SDPB Television at 10 p.m. Central, 9 p.m. Mountain Time. And of course, you can watch it at your own convenience experience on the web at sdpb.org. Now, just to recap some of the things that the governor talked about. When he looked back in September, it was looking a little rough. In fact, there was about a $6 million shortfall. The governor wondering where some of the programs in state government were going to be funded. But then the unclaimed property tax receipts stepped up, and there were some higher amounts. In fact, $30 million more than what was expected, with the unclaimed property tax as of November 1st exceeding $125 million. The governor has some ideas as to where some of that money can go. Of course, these are his proposals. As the legislature convenes in January, I'm sure there will be many more ideas as to where some of that money can go. We're going to be talking to some of our state lawmakers to hear what they have to say about the address and what they expect to take center stage during the 2014 legislative session. I understand Kara Hetland does have one of our state lawmakers now.
Thanks, Stephanie. And Senator Cory Brown is with me here now. And your reaction to what you heard today?
Well, I think in general, South Dakota's economy is moving forward, but it's clear that that's at a slower pace than a lot of us would like. I think the governor's done a nice job of coming up with an initial proposal that allows us to creatively use some of those one-time funds we came across and allow that to turn into ongoing revenue in the future.
And how about spending all of the one-time money? I mean, he has a plan to spend it all. Should he or should he not?
Well, I'm sure that'll be a point of discussion. I think the alternative is, if you don't spend it, essentially it's going to go into the reserves. And clearly he's laid out a proposal here that we're going to try to target 10% of our general fund revenues. And I think that's a good starting point for discussion. I think one of the problems we've always had is if there was a time when we had $107 million in the reserves and the answer was we're never going to touch it. And I'm not really sure what good that does you at the end of the day if the answer is going to be that we will never use that one way or the other. So I think by taking this approach of setting a target, and we could argue whether it's 10% or 15 or 5, we can try to manage to that year after year. And you know, quite frankly, I, for one, like his idea, if he's going to use these one-time dollars to buy down some of the bonds and the debt. I think that does us more good in the long term.
And any priorities that you have that were not addressed today?
I think, in general, I wouldn't say it wasn't addressed. I think one of the goals that I have certainly had is to ensure that we have a structurally sound, balanced budget that makes sense and that we're trying to move those areas that are priorities in our state ahead. And I think you see that with some of those examples. I think it's good that he was able to find a way to move K-12 from 1.6% increase to a 3% increase. It may not be as high as some would like, but I think at least that's, you know, a nice solid number that gives the schools something to be able to build on.
All right. Thank you so much for joining
us.
I appreciate it. Stephanie, back to you.
All right, I'm now joined by Representative Mark Feinstein from Sioux Falls. Good to see you again, sir. I want to talk to you about the governor's suggestion to not expand Medicaid, a lot of it due to what he says is a failure in the Affordable Care Act. What are your thoughts?
Well, I think that's a wrong position to take. I truly believe that, if nothing else, it's a huge input to the state with $200 million a year of economic development, and the money does go to our medical providers and to that industry, but it's an input into the state which would definitely come back to us, and I'm afraid of what the impact would do. And I think it's a moral obligation to fund Medicaid and with the expansion, and partly because people who are poor or don't have jobs, the disabled, they're on Medicaid already. We're talking about the working poor, people that already are working. They're meeting a moral obligation to try and do the best they can. Either better jobs aren't out there, or they just can't get those jobs. These are the people that it would help. And I think that's an obligation that we have as a state. And I think it's not even a political statement. It's turned into a huge political statement and a part of an issue. And I think that is a wrong approach to take. And if we're concerned about the future of the federal government not funding it, we can put a trigger on it to stop it. If the federal government doesn't live up to their obligation, we can say, well, we're done with that. But I think over the meantime, in the 7 years we'd be running it, we'd be better off, the people would be better off, we'd have healthier people, and that does nothing but help improve the state of South Dakota.
A question about the reserve fund. The governor gave us an idea of where we sit, about $140 million for the rainy day fund, suggesting that we should keep that fund at about 10%. What are your thoughts?
Well, 10% in based on his budget is about $140 million. I think it's fair to have the reserve fund, but I do think, because it is a rainy day fund, that we should use it when we do have a rainy day. For example, when there was a recession, that was the time to use it. And it can be replenished. We have the $70 million of unexpected one-time funds. Now, it's going to happen again. It's going to happen when there are these unclaimed one-time funds that we can use to help replenish. But I think it's good to have, at least good to have a measurement and something to base it on. And I think, again, if it gets higher, then we can use it to prepay things that the governor is proposing. I do like the fact the governor is listening and he is giving a 3% increase to state aid to education, 3% increase to state employees, and 3% to Medicaid providers when the inflation in the formula only calls for 1.6. I think it's definitely a step in the right direction, but I would prefer, the best thing would be to refund those pots to where they would have been had we not taken the drastic cut several years ago and had 0% increases.
All right, Representative Mark Feinstein, thanks for coming up and visiting with us. All right, Kara, back to you.
Thanks, Stephanie. And joining me now is Senator Craig Teason from Rapid City. Thanks for stopping and talking with us. Let's talk about health care.
That was a big part of the governor's budget.
Yeah, I think, you know, we saw a lot of references to health care in a lot of different parts of the budget, and it's a reminder to us of the continuing expense of health care. We also see areas where the federal government is decreasing its support in the Medicaid funding areas. And so, I mean, health care continues to be a very big expense for state government.
Just health insurance and not quite having the right projections with that
It appears in many areas. Obviously, the state health insurance pool has been underfunded. Our Medicaid expenses are high. All of those things, that portion of the budget, I think, continues to increase.
And where do you fall in on not expanding Medicaid?
Well, I personally think there's a good argument to be made to expand Medicaid. I don't know what the right timing is. I think we have to have some reassurance. I agree with the governor that the situation in the federal government is very unpredictable at this time. But I do believe that those 50,000 South Dakotans would be deserving, and I think they're already paying their expenses anyway. So I hope we continue to look at opportunities to expand Medicaid. I don't know exactly when the right time is. I realize that's a commitment that has to be taken very carefully.
Do you think the legislature will step out and say, no, we disagree with you, Governor, or do you think that the lawmakers will pretty much go with the budget presented?
Well, I think that remains to be seen. There'll be a lot of shifting of priorities as we move through the session, but I think it's pretty significant that the governor is not prepared to move forward at this time. And I'm sure there'll be support for people that think that's the prudent route to take.
Anything missing from his a budget proposal that you would like to have seen?
Well, I only noted, being from Rapid City, I need to do some more checking to make sure that we're continuing to fund our pine beetle effort out there. It continues to be a very huge problem. We think we're, you know, making some progress on that situation, but I think, you know, all of South Dakota recognizes how beautiful the Black Hills are. The pine beetles are doing a tremendous amount of damage, and we need to make sure that we're funding properly to deal with that issue and help to resolve it the best we can.
All right. Senator Teason, thank you so much for joining us. We appreciate it. And Stephanie, back to you.
All right. Thanks, Kara. We're now joined by Representative Bernie Hunha from Yankton. The governor recommended a 3% increase above the 1.6 for many programs. First, your thoughts on that, and then your overall thoughts on what you heard today.
Sure. Well, we heard a blizzard of numbers. And the governor handled it really well. He's good with numbers, and it was a good speech. The 3% for education, for Medicaid, and for state employees, all badly needed. I think we got to a point in South Dakota where, you know, we've got like 159 million, I think, in reserve funds. Now we have 120 million in new one-time monies. We've got another 700 or 800 million in trust funds. So we're just swimming in money, as some of us have been saying out here for a long time. And I give the governor and the budget staff credit. They acknowledge that it's time to spend some of that money, and the place it needs to go is the schools, health care, and state employees. And I think it's about as good a budget as Democrats could probably hope for, and I think it'll have pretty good support. I like the way he is divvying up the one-time money to try to build general funds in the future. That makes a lot of sense, and I think there'll be good support for that.
All right. Every year there's the top issues that take center stage in Pierre. Hopefully we'll be visiting again when the session starts up. At this point, any idea what those top issues might be?
Well, it's going to continue to be education funding and health care. This doesn't heal our schools. We created a real problem for our schools a couple years ago, and since then we've been, on the average, budgeting school increases at about 1.5%, while state government has been growing at 3%. So this in no way fixes the problem, but it's a good step in the right direction, probably as much as we could hope for. Education funding and how that relates to economic development will still be big. The other big thing the governor just touched on would be health care, especially as it relates to Medicaid expansion. Number one public policy issue, I think, in South Dakota and across the country. And it would be a huge mistake if we don't participate. The governor says he doesn't want to participate at this time because he's just not sure that the rollout is going very well. The reason the rollout is not going very well is because people won't participate. So we've got to get on board. Democrats have to give some. The Republicans have to give some. We have to make this thing work. That's going to be a huge issue this session.
All right. All right. Representative Bernie Hunhoff, the minority leader for the House of Representatives. We'll see you back here in January, sir. All right. And that will wrap up today's coverage of the governor's budget address. For all of us with South Dakota Public Broadcasting, we appreciate you tuning in. Again, it will re-air tonight at 10 p.m. Central, 9 p.m. Mountain, and you can watch whenever you want on sdpb.org. Now for all of us, on behalf of Kara Hetland, I'm Stephanie Rissler. Thanks for watching.
State House program funding provided by the South Dakota Bar Foundation, the educational and charitable arm of South Dakota lawyers and judges. SDN Communications, integrating phone and data technology for your office. Learn more at sdncommunications.com.